Everybody, we're back. Welcome to Saki Speakeasy Podcast. I'm your host, Saki Speaks. Thanks for giving me a slice of your most precious commodity, your time. I truly appreciate you. Y'all please do me a favor in case she shows up. Show moderator Love Jones a little love, please, and thank you. And also make sure that you've liked the video on your way in the door. And if you haven't already, please consider subscribing to the channel, making sure to click that notification bell and select all so you don't miss out on a single chapter. Now, with that being said, welcome to all of my brand new sippers and speakers. I'm so happy that you subscribe to the channel, and I hope that you find a reason to stick around. And welcome back to my returning sippers and speakers with their badasses, and those of you catching this on the replay. Thanks for coming back one more time to love up on your girl, because I can't seem to get enough of the way y'all love on me. Now, child, I'm hoping like hell that this stupid firmware update that they did will work. We gonna see. I don't know. But anyway, I'm gonna say hello to those of you that are here. Welcome back, Danielle. And welcome to Angela F. You're new. All right. She said, never caught you live before. Currently listening to playback of, okay, Property of Originator. Absolutely. Okay. All right. Well, thank you for being here. And y'all welcome her to the Speakeasy. Welcome back, Church Lady. And you too, Jaleesa. And Demetia, not the last live had you like, God damn it, Kathleen. I can dig it because I was the same way. Y'all, I was ready to pick all this shit up and throw it in the garbage. But yeah, they did some sort of firmware update, child. So we're going to see if they get the eggs to scrambling. We're going to see. All right. Welcome back, Dior. Thank you for coming back, lovey. I appreciate you. And it looks like that's about it. Okay. So we left off in the middle of chapter 5, I think, child. Let me see where it puts me. Yeah, we left off with her in the middle. I don't know. I think we should just start chapter 5 all the way over because that's kind of where I'm at with it at this point. I'm just the fuck over it. All right, so that's what we're going to do. We're going to start over. All right, forgive me for moving this microphone, but let me get the timestamp, child. So we're going to see how this thing works and I don't know, child, this fucking shit. All right, got me all discombobulated. Y'all just don't know how much cussing I've been doing. Poor little lady, child. She'll be all right, though. All right, so I got the timestamp. So about 10 seconds, y'all. And then we'll start with chapter 5 and see what it do here. All right. Chapter 5, Law, the following morning. Honey slept peacefully in my bed as I lay there and gazed up at the ceiling. The night before kept playing over and over in my head. She definitely stood her ground better than expected. My mama had my mind so fucked up that I took my anger out on Honey. It wasn't fair to her, but it seemed as if she liked the pain. For years, I'd been lied to, whether if it was by Pops or Ma. I didn't know what the hell was the truth, but I damn sure was gonna get to the bottom of it after our honeymoon. Tossing the covers back, I sat on the edge of the bed and gawked at Honey over my shoulder. Her chest rose and fell as she lightly snored. For someone to be as beautiful as her, one wouldn't think she snored like that. The way Honey stood against me, it was like no other. She was slowly tugging on my heartstrings, and I wasn't certain how to feel about the shit. Getting up from bed, I went into the bathroom to handle my hygiene. Streets was supposed to meet me at his house to speak with Mom before we boarded the jet to Greece. I wanted to make sure she didn't fucking disappear again before I was able to fully grasp what the hell was going on. Once I was done with my shower, I grabbed my towel off the hook next to the shower door and wrapped it around my frame. I exited the bathroom and grabbed a notepad out the nightstand alongside the bed. Honey was still knocked out, and I didn't want her to wake up and panic that I was gone, so I wrote her a short note, letting her know that I stepped out for a couple hours and we'd head out after breakfast. After getting dressed, I exited the bathroom and went downstairs. Frederick should have already been outside without me having to call him. "Where's Miss Honey?" Nigel asked as I neared the front door. "She's still up there in the room sleeping. I didn't want to wake her. Can you have breakfast prepared for when she wakes up? I have to run and take care of something. I'll be back in a couple hours." Nigel nodded and I exited the house. Frederick jumped from the driver's seat and opened the back door for me. "I'm going to Streets' house," I told him and climbed into the seat. He shut the door and got back into the driver's seat. Pulling my phone out, I checked the jet to ensure that it was going to be ready for takeoff. When we made it to the Streets' house, his truck was already in the driveway. I was up pretty early, so that only meant he'd been up way before me to even beat me here. Going up to the front door, I knocked on it and waited for him to answer it. "What's up, bruh?" he said. Soon as he opened the door, Ma's laughter sent chills down my spine. It had been so long since I heard it. "Where's she at?" I wasted no time asking. "In the dining room. She was just having breakfast." I trotted down the hallway and stopped in the doorway when I saw Ma sitting at the table with a glass of orange juice up to her lips. Coco sat in the chair alongside her and snickered. All laughter ceased when they realized I was standing there. "Coco, can you give us some space?" What I needed to talk to her about didn't have shit to do with her. I don't even understand why Streets brought her in the first place. Hold on, y'all. Let me see what's happening here. Does it sound okay to y'all? Okay, I'm hoping it's okay. We'll see. Coco looked over at Streets as if she wanted his approval for her to excuse herself from the room. If she didn't get up on her own, I was going to remove her ass myself and deal with Streets later. A few moments later, she got up and stepped out of the dining room. "Do you have to always be so rude?" Ma questioned me. Little did she know it was her so-called death that turned me this way. "What are your plans?" I asked her, ignoring her question. "What do you mean? Now that you let it be known that you're not dead, what are you fucking plans?" Not what are you fucking plans, but that's what it says, y'all, and I fixed it earlier. Anyway, "I plan to make your father pay for what he did to me." "I still don't believe you." "Have you asked him about it? If his right eye twitches when you ask, then you know I'm not lying. Just ask him. See what he says. I really don't have time for this bullshit right now. We have a flight to catch. Streets, I'm putting someone on the house to keep watch on her ass to make sure she doesn't go anywhere." "And how long are y'all gonna be gone?" she quickly asked, as if she had something better to do than sit around and wait for us to come back. "Does it really matter? Your ass is staying in here till we come back," I said, and strolled out of there. And then there's a break in the chapter. By the time I made it back to the house, Honey was already in the dining room enjoying her breakfast. She sat there with her hair balled up on top of her head and in a huge t-shirt. Thoughts of the night before seeped into my mind as I stood there in the doorway admiring her. The way she took everything I dished out of her ass last night had me wanting to bend her over this fucking table in this exact moment. I held my composure, though, and found my way over to the end of the table. "Good morning, Mr. Blanco," escaped her lips, and the corner of her mouth quirked as she lifted a piece of bacon up to it. Her gaze met mine, and it lingered. "I'm really stuck with your ass, huh?" "Definitely." Honey got up from the table, and my eyes went to her smooth thighs. She strutted in my direction and straddled me. The scent of vanilla swept my nostrils, alerting me that she'd freshly showered. Her fingertips coursed up my chest and didn't stop till they cupped my face. "No matter what you think, you deserve love just as much as the next person. I'm gonna love you with every fiber of my being till there's no breath left in my body. Stop fighting what's destined to be." Her lips brushed mine, and my dick began to brick. "Someone's greeting me this morning," she said, in between kisses. Her lips caressed my chin, and she lifted to her feet. Honey got down on her knees underneath the table and tugged at my belt. My eyes shot over to Nigel, who stood in his spot, gazing straight ahead, minding his business. My eyes rolled to the back of my head soon as I felt the warmth of Honey's mouth. She wasn't great at sucking dick, but she wasn't bad at it either. I'd give her a few months, and she'd be handling my shit like a fucking pro. I pulled the scrunchie off her hair, letting it fall. Whenever her hair was down, it palpitated my heart. My fingers intertwined in her mane, roughly gripping it as I guided her up and down on my dick. The moment she gagged, I knew it was activating her saliva. The shit dripped down to my balls, wetting up my pants. A moan escaped my lips, and then my head tilted back. Fuck! Just like that. Honey began to make this humming sound, coursing vibrations through my dick. My toes began to curl and my seeds sprouted to the back of her throat. Yanking her mouth off my dick, I pulled her to her feet and pushed her against the table. My fingertips glided her thigh, snaking underneath the lining of her thongs. One yank and they ripped. "You've been a bad girl," I whispered into her ear and bent her further over the table. Her pussy soaked my fingers to the touch. "How bad?" she whispered back. Gripping her left leg, I placed it on the table and positioned myself at her soaking wet center. My dick entered her effortlessly. Soon as her pussy touched my dick, it creamed all over it. She was making it impossible as fuck for me to not erupt inside her. Roughly gripping her by her mane, I pulled her head back and nipped her earlobe. Honey began to match me thrust for thrust. The table shook, glasses clattered. The only thing on my mind at the moment was holding this nut as long as possible, but the water park between her thighs was drowning the fuck out of me. "God, I'm about to come," Honey screamed out, and it was the most angelic thing I'd ever heard in my life. "Hold it," I shot back. What? I didn't fucking stutter, hold that shit. "But, I can't." Honey's pussy was sounding like Mama A was in the kitchen whipping up her famous macaroni. I'm telling her to hold her shit when I could barely hold my own. My hand wrapped tightly around her throat from the front, and I said, "What the fuck?" I said, "Hold it till I say you can release it." But, fuck. "Don't you fucking do it, honey. Hold that shit." I gripped her tightly by the hip and thrust rapidly inside her. My teeth clenched. I could no longer hold on to the nut that had been building up ever since I entered her pussy. "Come for me," I ordered. "Come for me, bae." "God damn," Honey screamed at the top of her lungs as her juices flooded my dick and my seeds sprouted inside her. I stood there till my dick was done throbbing, then slipped out of her. Honey fell flat against the table with her ass up in the air. "Go finish eating so we can get ready to go." "I don't think I can move," she said, with her face buried into the table. A slippery pink pussy gazed at me, and I leaned down, sucking gently on her clit. Honey's hand slapped against the table, and she jumped from the touch of my mouth. "If you don't get this pussy out my face, I'm gonna suck your soul out through it." "But I can't," she whined, still laying there. "Fine." I slid my chair up to the table, tossed her legs over my shoulder, and dug into her pussy as if it was my last fucking meal. And that's the end of that chapter. Okay, it seems like we're back. What a way to come back. Yes, God. Ooh, Lord. I'm mad that he gonna force her to hold hers, but his punk ass is ready to tap out. Tackhead bastard. All right, so Demetia said the sound is good. Okay, thank you, Demetia. All right, thank all of y'all telling me the sound was good. All right, who else did I see? Well, yeah. Okay, that was Demetia. Okay, got her. Got Dior. Hey, Dior. Angelisa. Buck, who likes to fuck? Hey, welcome. Thank you for being here. I appreciate you. Hey, Michi. Welcome, welcome. Thank you for being here as well. All right, so I think I got everybody. Nope, no, I didn't. Y'all listen. L Boogie came back. Welcome back, Boo. And you too, Michael Anderson. And you too, Marva. Yes, indeed, we are back. All right, let me shut up, y'all, so we can get get some more going on here before this shit decide to fucking jap out on us again. Because I swear, somebody gonna fuck around and find out if this shit happen again. All right, so I got my timestamp, child. Done left my damn coffee over yonder in the kitchen, but that's all right. We're gonna fuck around. Look at this shit. Okay. Chapter 6, Coco, Greece. I lay there in my lounge chair underneath the umbrella with my huge Fendi shades covering my eyes, listening to my surroundings. The water was crystal clear, the most beautiful thing I'd ever seen in my life. Pictures really didn't do Greece justice. We'd been here for a couple days now, and I wasn't prepared to go home. If I could move over here, I definitely would. Though it was our honeymoon, Law and Streets was out handling some business that they said wouldn't take too long, so Honey and I decided we'd spend a little time on the beach. I couldn't wait to tell her what my experience was like with Streets. That was the first thing that we dove into once we were alone. According to her, Law hadn't been able to keep his hands off her, and she needed a little break. Whatever he'd been doing, he had to have been putting it down, because that girl has been sleeping like she's with child. My eyes drifted over next to me where Honey lay there with her mouth wide open. I snickered and lightly shook her. She jumped from her sleep so fast and said, I wasn't asleep. If you don't close your mouth, a bug gonna crawl in it. Shut up, she replied and grabbed her drink off the table next to her. If she asked me, the way she was snoring and carrying on, she didn't need it. The boys haven't made it back yet? Nope. I grabbed my coconut water and took a sip from it. How long have they been gone? Grabbing my phone off the table, I hit the power button and responded, almost 2 hours. Honey let off a sigh and said, thought they said it wasn't going to take long. Cutting my eyes at her, I spoke, so you're rushing him back now? Just moments ago, you seemed to be glad that he was leaving. Oh, shut up, she playfully nudged me. You want to do some exploring while we wait? If I lay here a moment longer, I'm going to be black as hell. You're under an umbrella. I'm already about 3 shades darker. I feel it. Girl, bye. I got up from the chair and grabbed my cover up. Honey did the same, and we took the short stroll back to our villa. I'll meet you in the living room in about 30 minutes, she said, and went toward the end of the villa where her room was located. I headed to mine to see what I wanted to toss on. Honey said, go exploring. Therefore, there was no telling where we'd end up messing around with her. Going through my clothes, I finally settled on this denim skirt and white crop top that tied over my rib cage. I tossed on my white Air Force Ones, brushed my fingers through my curls, and was good to go. By the time I made it to the living room, Honey was nowhere to be found. It was well over 30 minutes, so I went to her bedroom to check and see how much longer she was going to need. When I stopped in the doorway, I found her sprawled out in the bed, still wearing her swimsuit from earlier, knocked out. Sis ain't even make it past the bed to get changed. That's a damn shame. Shaking my head, I tread toward the front door, not even wanting to wake her. I decided I was just going to go out and sightsee on my own. There was a Tahoe sitting outside waiting for us. Streets and Law made certain that we had drivers soon as we touched down. Since I didn't want Streets to be worried when he made it back to the villa and I was gone, I shot him a quick text, letting him know that I was going out alone for a bit and would be right back. My phone quickly buzzed with his response. Be careful. Don't go too far and make sure you stay close to the driver. Yes. Okay. The driver got out the truck and opened the door for me. I want to go see the Parthenon, I told him, and slipped into the back seat. I'd been doing some research when I arrived for some good tourist attractions to visit, and that was one of the first ones on my list. It was beautiful from the pictures, and I had to see it in person. Soon as we arrived, he followed me out there, and my mouth dropped. It was gorgeous as hell. Take a picture for me, I told him, and handed him my phone. Everywhere I went on this honeymoon, whether if I was alone or not, I was taking pictures to remember everything. He snapped a few pictures for me, and I wandered around for a bit before I made my way toward the edge, and my breath was taken away at the panoramic view. I could truly be up here forever. After snapping a few pictures, my phone buzzed. It's a text from Streets. We're on the way back to the villa. Dinner? I noticed what time it was, and I could definitely go for a bite to eat, so I replied, sure. Snapping a few more pictures, I trotted back to the truck so that I could meet Streets back at the villa and get ready for our date. And that's the end of that chapter. Child, listen. I don't want to tax this fucking whack-ass fucking thing, so it seemed like it's going okay, eh? I think so, child. We're going to cross everything on our body except our cooter lips and hair follicles. Oh, my God. Listen. All right. I don't even. I got problems. Just fuck it. All right. Let me get this next timestamp. Oh, I forgot to see if anybody else came in. Okay. Hey, Sydney. Welcome back. Hey, Kiana Henderson. Welcome. She said, hi, Saki Mods chat. Dropping out of the clouds to say hello, everyone. To say hello, everyone. Usually a part of the replay game. Currently listening to the Valentine series. Okay, well, thank you for being here. I appreciate you. Y'all welcome Kiana Henderson to the Speakeasy. Even though she took it away, but it's still up here for me. I told y'all it stay up here for me whether y'all delete it or not. So that's it. All right. I was trying to get that other. Here we go. I think we should be okay at this point. Otherwise, I'm beating up everybody. All right. 5 seconds. Chapter 7, Streets. Shit today took a bit longer than expected. We didn't want to do any work while we were on our honeymoon, but Pop swore that it was important that we handled it as soon as possible. Child, she put impairment. I hope it wasn't impairment. No, God. Law was irritated as hell to receive a phone call from him when he hadn't even been able to question him about Ma yet. It took everything in him to remain calm during that phone call. Once we made it off the phone, he made it known that he was dealing with him soon as we made it back. When we got back to the villa, Law and I went our separate ways so we could get ready for dinner. We decided to take the girls out for a nice dinner on the beach since we took away from their entire day. Coco seemed to have had fun, though. While we were gone, she sent me several pictures of her adventure. Entering our bedroom, I found Coco sitting on the bench at the foot of the bed, rubbing her body down with lotion. The way her hands were caressing her legs, I swear it made me want to go over there and fold them behind her head. We have yet to do anything extreme in the bedroom so far because I was trying to take my time with her and not make her feel uncomfortable. Well, you should tell your brother to try that shit with his wife, but unfortunately, he ain't doing that because he's a dickhole. I haven't even allowed her to give me head yet because I wasn't certain if she was comfortable doing so. However long it took to get her comfortable was fine with me. Damn, I missed you. Seeped from my lips and her eyes shot in my direction. A huge smile plastered her face, letting me know she felt the same way. You already know I missed you, she said, lifting to her feet. My eyes roamed her sexy ass frame as she strutted in my direction in nothing but her black bra and thong. Her arms draped my neck and our lips collided. My heart damn near burst in my chest. The way Coco made me feel should have been a fucking crime. Let me hop in the shower right quick so we can go. I'll take care of you after dinner, I promised her when she released my lips. I want to take care of you. She cupped my dick through my pants and the motherfucker was brick as hell. If I didn't get in the shower and soon, we weren't going to make it out this fucking room. I promise you can. Soon as we make it back, for now, we have to shower. I don't want to keep Law and Honey waiting, I told her and peeled her away from my frame. I went into the bathroom and jumped in the shower. Since I'd already wasted time admiring Coco, I kept the shit short and sweet. Getting out, I went into the bedroom and Coco had already picked an outfit out for me and had it lying on the bed with my briefs. She was completely dressed, leaning down in the mirror, sliding her lip gloss on her lips. This black mini dress adorned her body. The red bottom pumps she wore, I thought about telling her to change them for where we were going, but decided against it. If she had trouble walking in them, I'd just pick her up and carry her. I quickly got dressed, and by the time we made it to the living room, Law and Honey were already in there. You sure went with me earlier, Coco joked, as Honey tossed back a shot. Listen, I was tired. This man right here? Honey's eyes drifted to Law, who stood there with his phone in his hand. Baby, he be keeping me on my toes. Our ride is out there, Law said, and shoved his phone into his pocket. We all exited the villa and climbed into the Escalade. The ride wasn't too long. We ended up hiring someone to put together a nice little dinner on the beach for us. They pitched a white tent, lined it with lights, and placed two circular tables underneath. Rose petals rested against the sand as we made our way toward our tent. Standing next to it were two women who were going to be our servers for the night. Everything for the night was well thought out. The girls deserved it. This is beautiful, Coco said as she clung to my arm. Her shoes kept digging in the sand. Off top, I already knew I was going to have to carry her back to the truck. Y'all deserve the best, I replied and kissed her temple. Good evening, the server said as we stepped underneath the tent. Coco and I went over to our table and Law and Honey did the same. We decided on separate tables because after all, we were on our honeymoon and needed some form of privacy. I pulled Coco's chair out for her and she sat down. The server immediately grabbed the bottle of champagne and began to pour us a glass. I've really been trying to figure out how I'm going to repay you for all this, Coco blurted, catching me by surprise. You don't have to repay me for anything. I've only been doing what I'm supposed to do. It's my duty as your husband to make sure that you're well taken care of. But still, I feel like I need to do something for you. I tell you what, when we make it back home, why don't you bake up a batch of those chocolate chip cookies and we can call us even? Coco snickered. That's nowhere near even, but it's a start. Your dinner, the server said as she placed a plate down in front of Coco, then brought the other to me. Before I was even able to pick up my fork and look at my food good, my phone vibrated in my pocket. The shit should have been on Do Not Disturb, but I'd been keeping it accessible for emergencies. Reaching into my pocket, I slipped the phone out and saw that it was a text from Vex. So Vex's text says, Saint wants to meet with you now. And he responds, out of pocket. He'd have to wait till we make it back. I eased my phone back into my pocket and returned my attention back to Coco. She'd already began eating her food. Sorry. How is it? I asked, feeling my phone vibrate again. Pulling it out, I looked down and saw that Vex had texted me again. He said it can't wait. Sighing, I shot him a message back. Give me like 30 minutes. I'll video call him. What's wrong? Coco questioned me. I gotta take care of something right quick. Are you serious? She frowned. Yeah, I hate to do this right now, but it can't wait. Your food is gonna get cold. I know. Getting up from the table, I pecked Coco on the center of her forehead and approached Law's table. Law finally cut his steak and said, this better be important while you're interrupting my dinner. Saint wants to speak to us. His eyes cut to me and he replied, that nigga can wait till we make it back home. They say it's important. Law dropped his knife and fork onto the plate and fully faced me. Nothing is that fucking important for them to be interrupting our honeymoon. Saint needs to fuck off. Can we just see what they want? If it's bullshit, we can just go on about our business and deal with it when we make it back home. Law's jaw muscles clenched. I'll be right back, he told Honey, without making eye contact with her, and rose to his feet. We both trotted out to the truck and climbed into the back of it. Once we were securely inside, I dialed Saint's number on the MacBook and waited for him to answer. Tell me why you're interrupting my fucking honeymoon right now. You're on your honeymoon? Saint questioned and stroked his goatee. Don't act fucking stupid. You already know I just got married. The shit was all over the city and blogs. What the fuck do you want? I was reaching back out because I haven't heard anything else back from you about Lilith. Are you fucking serious right now? I ain't about to sit here and listen to this bullshit. Law gripped the door handle, but what Saint said next stopped him from exiting. This another family that's thinking about going into business with us. Before I sat down with him, I wanted to see what you was going to do first. And who's this family? The Columbos. Soon as that name escaped his lips, I knew that what was about to be a problem. We didn't fuck with them whatsoever. They were reckless and had caused trouble for us several times in the past. After their father Samuel died, they simmered down a bit, but there was no telling how much longer they were going to be quiet. We're in, but the moment I feel something's off, I'm off in your ass. And if you fucking interrupt me again while I'm on my goddamn honeymoon for some bullshit, I'm going to place a fucking bullet in your ass. Law casually told him and exited the truck. We'll set up a meeting soon as we get back, I said, and disconnected the car. And that's the end of that chapter. Child, listen. Oh, Lord. All right. Hey, Nora. Welcome back, boo. Thank you for being here, lovey. I appreciate you. Let me see who else. She told my Law isn't that. I mean, he ain't that bad, but he's still a fucking itchy asshole with a hemorrhoid. Hey, Jazzy. Welcome, boo. Thank you for being here, lovey. I appreciate you. And you too, Kay. And who else, child? Let me see. Oh, okay. I think that's it. All right. Let me get this next timestamp. Lord have mercy. Y'all have no idea how annoyed I am right now. All right. Let me see. I don't even know what else could be. Because I know it's not the service anymore. Because that shit is back. It seems to be okay. All right. I don't know. And at this point, I don't give a fuck. We gonna be here until the shit. Well, I ain't gonna say till it fuck up because it might not fuck up no more. And y'all be like, you said. No, God. Mm-mm. But I will stay until I'm sick of it. Whatever it is, child. All right, here we go. I got the timestamp, so we just waiting for the countdown. Y'all, I think people don't even be realizing that this shit ain't no damn joke when you're trying to read and watch. Chapter 8, Law. Once dinner was over, we silently rode back to the villa. By the time I made it back to my food, it was cold as shit, and that pissed me off even more. The shit Saint called us with definitely could have waited. He'd been waiting this long for a response from us. He could have waited a few more days. When we made it back to the villa, we went inside to our bedrooms. I immediately went into the bathroom to take a shower and cool myself down before my frustrations were taken out on Honey. I'd been fucking her brains out trying to get rid of all that built-up tension inside me that I acquired over time when I wasn't fucking anything. But here's the problem. You dumping all that angry-ass seed in her, then y'all gonna have some little fucking serial killer-ass baby. Stop doing that shit. Exiting the bathroom with my towel wrapped around my waist, I saw honey lying across the bed in some red lingerie. She dimmed the lights in the bedroom and lit a few candles. "I was wondering when you were gonna come out of there," she said, and sat straight up on the bed. A red blindfold dangled from her index finger. We hadn't even been fucking long, and she was already turning into the freak I desired. "Where'd you get that?" "This?" Her eyes drifted to the blindfold, and the corner of her mouth quirked. "I grabbed it from the house when we were packing. I've never used one before and wanted to see what it felt like." "You sure you want to do that?" I asked her, as she climbed out of bed and tiptoed in my direction. "Oh, I'm more than sure," was her response. She rested the blindfold on top of her head and coursed her fingertips from my wet abs up to my chest. "I want to see what it feels like to come when I can't see anything." Gripping her underneath the arms, I carried her over to the bed and tossed her against it. A giggle escaped her lips. "I just love the way you handle me in the bedroom." I went over to my duffel and grabbed the restraints out of it. Of course I wasn't about to leave the house without them. Grabbing honey by the wrist, I tied her to the bed. As I hovered over her frame, our gaze synced. Her eyes were filled with lust as she anticipated what I was about to do to her next. "You're fucking beautiful," seeped from my lips. This was the first time I openly admitted to her that she was gorgeous. Maybe it was the wine talking. I did gulp down almost 2 bottles before we made it back here, trying my best to remain calm. I don't know who said what, child. One of them said, oh, okay, he said it. "All right, I love you." My heart banged against my rib cage. "You love me?" "Uh-huh." I slid the blindfold over her eyes and just sat there admiring her. When I first was told that I'd have to marry honey, I never once thought that she'd actually grow to love me. Wrapping my hand around her throat, my lips caressed her chin and she moaned. My lips moved down to her breasts. I gently tugged on her nipple through her teddy. "I'm a monster, remember? How can you love somebody like me?" For whatever reason, I just couldn't believe that honey actually loved me. "That's exactly why I love you. You're a monster in the streets and in the sheets. But outside of that, you go against everything you believe in, and you're gentle and sweet with me. We're meant for each other, Law. I feel it in my bones that you're my soulmate." The hairs on the back of my neck stood up. Honey was it for me. I'd been sensed it and just didn't want to admit it. As I eased down to her dripping wet pussy, her scent crept up my nostrils. If my dick wasn't already standing at full attention, that damn sure would have done it. She spread her legs, and that was when I noticed she had an opening where her pussy was. That's the reason why her scent was so strong. "I think I love you too," left my lips before I dove head first into her pussy. Well, I had that all fucked up, but who gives a fuck? Anyway, and then there's a break in the chapter. Welcome back, Felicia. Thank you for coming back, child. All right. They both already pregnant. Back home. We hadn't been back home long before I dropped honey off and made my way to Pops's house so I can talk to him about Ma. It had been killing me to hold off for this long, and I couldn't wait a moment longer. There was no telling what the fuck I was going to do if I found out Pops really tried to kill Ma. When I arrived at his house, Mama A was getting out of her truck. She stopped in her tracks and turned to face my truck with her arms folded over her chest. From the scowl plastered on her face, I sensed she was angry about something. Hurriedly, I got out and approached her. Her hand connected to the side of my face before I was able to peck her on the cheek. "When the fuck were y'all gonna tell me that Zara was still alive? How you found out?" "I went over to Streets' house to greet them when they made it back, and she was in there. Y'all weren't gonna tell me that she was still alive?" "We haven't really told anyone. We've been keeping it on the low till we figure out exactly what's going on. Pops don't know either, so for our sake, can you not say anything to him about it till we get everything under control?" "So you're basically asking me to lie to my son?" Her eyes narrowed. From what I can tell, she'd never lied to him in her life, but this was important, and in order for me to figure everything out and handle it accordingly, the less people that knew, the better. "For me?" "Fine." She tapped her cheek with her index finger, and my lips found it with ease. "I'm about to head over there and pay honey a visit," she said, and found her way back to her truck. I stood there till it was no longer in view, then entered the house. After searching high and low for Pops, I found him in the backyard with his golfing club, practicing his swing. Since it had been coming closer to time for me to fully take over, he'd been spending more time doing things he always wanted to do, like golfing. "You wasted no time coming here as soon as you landed," he spoke and took a swing. "I needed to speak with you about something." He positioned his club at the ball and tapped the air before glancing over his shoulder at me. "What?" "What I'm about to ask you may seem a little bizarre, but did you have anything to do with Mama's death?" "What?" His brows furrowed and he faced me. "What type of fucking question is that? Can you just answer it? Why would I want to kill your mama?" Turning his frame, he fully faced me. "Somebody said I did?" I studied his face for any indication he might be lying before I responded. "No, I just really want to find out what happened to her. After all these years, why don't you just let your mama rest in peace?" He turned back around and swung at his ball. I stood there observing him as he shielded his eyes from the sun with his hand, watching his ball shoot across the sky. I was getting to the bottom of this shit one way or another. And that's the end of that chapter. Did his father's eye twitch? Apparently not, because he didn't say nothing. Or did he miss the twitch? That's the question. Nigga might have missed the twitch, for as we know. All right, let me get this next timestamp, child. All right. Okay, so I got my time stamp, but we just got to let it count down. Chapter 9, Coco, a week later. After everything that happened, Honey and I were finally focused back at school and ready to close out the semester. Today was a breeze. Professor Letterman finished up her lecture and I jetted out of class. The only thing on my mind was making it home so I can see Streets. Soon as we got back, Streets had all my things already moved into his home. He even went as far as to ask if I wanted to redecorate, make it feel like home to me, or go out and find a brand new one. I saw nothing wrong with his home, but I didn't mind adding my own little touches here and there. As I exited the building, I saw Marcia coming down the sidewalk with a baby stroller. Honey and I stopped talking to her altogether once we found out she'd been sleeping with Law behind her back. The shit was foul as hell. She was supposed to be our sister, but that only proved that not everybody was your friend. I had to pass her to get to the parking lot where my truck was waiting for me. If my stomach wasn't touching my back, I would have gone the other way just to avoid her. The closer I got, the slower she began to stroll. If I didn't know any better, the hole wanted to be seen. "Coco," she called out my name as we approached each other. "Marcia, I don't have nothing to say to you right now." I proceeded to pass her, but she gripped me by the forearm, stopping me. Yanking from her, I took a couple steps back. "I know you're mad at me about what happened with Law, but let's be for real. I was already fucking him before she got him. You act like you couldn't open your mouth and say something. You didn't have to keep fucking him. You could have stopped soon as you found out that she had to marry him. If I didn't know any better, I'd think that you kept fucking him to be spiteful. Look where the shit got you." I looked down at the stroller. Since we weren't fucking with her, I'd blocked her ass on all social media. We hadn't really been seeing her, and now all of a sudden, she was pushing around a damn baby stroller. "Whose baby is that?" I asked, just to see what the hell was really going on. "I'm babysitting my little cousin." She pulled the blanket back and I saw the baby peacefully sleeping in the stroller. "I came up here to try and talk to you and Honey. I miss hanging with y'all. Y'all my sisters. I don't know what to do without y'all." "Well, I'll tell you what to do without him, you funky bitch. Move on. Continue on with your raggedy ass life and leave him the fuck alone." "Well, you should have thought about that before you fucked one of us over. Once you fuck one over, you fuck over both of us. You already know that. I don't hate you or anything, but I can't fuck with you like that. I don't trust you." "Bye, Marcia," I said, and rounded her. "Coco!" She called out my name, but I kept trotting to my truck. Once I was securely inside the truck, I pulled my phone out and called Honey to tell her about Marcia. She needed a heads up that she was looking for so that she wouldn't catch her by surprise. "Hey, Cole," she answered. "Just to let you know, Marcia walking around campus looking for you. I just saw her. She seems to be wanting to apologize, but it don't seem sincere to me." "How you gonna apologize, then try to justify why you did something? Fuck that hoe. If she knows what's best for her, she'd stay the fuck away from me. You good?" "Yeah, Professor Patterson just pissed me the fuck off. The man gave me a B on a paper that was clearly an A. I got a trick for his ass, though." Snickering, I asked, "And what's that?" "He keeps playing with my damn GPA. I'm gonna send Law up here to see him." "I think you've been hanging around Mama Ada far too much," I interrupted in laughter. "She's rubbing off on you." and you act like that's a problem. Girl, take that B. You'll be all right. Whatever. I gotta run. I'll call you later. Leaning forward, I grabbed the phone charger and slipped it into my phone. The ride to the house was silent as hell and didn't take long. When I got there, Streets wasn't there, even though I didn't really expect him to be. He was never home when I made it in from school. Most nights, he came in just in time for dinner. He'd make certain he checked in with me during the day, but for the most part, he was out there working, and that was understandable. The driver pulled the door open for me, and I exited the truck. By the time I made it to the door, Donna opened it with a huge bouquet of red roses in her hand. "These came for you earlier," she said, and handed them over to me. "They're beautiful. Who are they from?" I asked, as if I didn't already know the answer. "Your husband, silly. Where would you like me to put them? The bedroom is fine. Did he say what time he was coming in today?" "No." "Okay." I followed her to the bedroom so that I can freshen up. Streets sending me flowers just because was going to have to be something that I got used to. He found himself doing a lot of things for me, and I was still getting used to them. Some might think I was crazy for marrying him in the spur of the moment, the way I did, but to me, that was the best decision of my life. I bet it is, because, bitch, you hit a lick. You're a whole fucking billionaire. The fuck? She act like, oh, you know, it's no big deal. Girl, no God. All right, hold on. Let me get this next time stamp. Okay, let me see. All right, so I got my next time stamp. Oh, okay. But he was looking away from him then. I'm talking about when he turned around to talk to him. Did he miss it? That's what I need to know. Because I feel like, why would the mother lie like that? I don't think she would lie like that, right? I mean, what reason would she have to lie? She literally, you know, was snatched away from her kids. So, oh, yeah, she probably should have told her that, Nora. You're right, because I would have said something, but you know how people are. I don't know. I just feel like she should have said something. You're right. She definitely should have said something. All right, let me shut up. Chapter 10, Honey, a year later. Well, damn. That was fast. How we get a whole year? Y'all know they be advancing this shit. I'm like, a whole year? All right. My leg bounced as I sat there in this cold room alone. It seemed as if I'd been in there for an eternity. If they didn't come in here soon, I was going to lose the bit of my mind I have left. Goosebumps coursed my skin from the cool air that drifted down above my head from the vent. They say doctor's offices be cold as they are to kill germs, but damn, they be trying to freeze people to death. Normally, I would have brought a light jacket in with me, but somehow today I forgot to grab it out the truck when I arrived. I was running a bit behind and knew that once that 15-minute mark hit, they weren't going to see me. The knock at the door sank my heart to the depths of my stomach. And you know what? Anyway, let me be quiet. The door opened and in stepped Dr. Tate. The smile she normally wore was replaced with concern as she shut the door behind her. "Hey, Mrs. Blanco, I'm glad that you were able to come in at such short notice to discuss your lab results." She stepped in front of me and took a seat on the rolling stool. Placing her laptop on the counter, she gave me her undivided attention. I rubbed my clammy hands against my pants. "I'm just going to get straight to it. According to your blood work, you're infertile. You'll never be able to get pregnant." Her words trailed off after those escaped her lips. "Wait, are you sure?" I blurted and asked, remembering that I signed a contract with Law's family stating that I was supposed to produce an heir. If I wasn't able to have any kids, there was no telling what they were going to do. "I'm sure. You can look at the results if you want. I'll take your word for it. You have an ovulation disorder. I turned her words out again. Not turned them. Damn, I'm always saying this girl turned something out. I tuned her words out again. My heart banged against my chest and lungs felt like they were closing in on me. The only thing I can think about at the moment was getting the hell out of here. "I have to go," I said and lifted to my feet. My head began to spin. I stumbled, replaying her words over in my head as I rushed toward the door. "Mrs. Blanco, are you okay?" Dr. Tate asked as she came out behind me. I have to go," I repeated and ran toward the exit. Soon as I got outside into the truck, the tears began to fall. How was I going to break it to Law that I wasn't able to have children? What if he didn't want to be with me anymore? "Take me to my parents' house," I told the driver. Coco had told me that she was going to be doing some studying there after school to keep from being in that big-ass house alone for so long. To keep myself from going insane, I needed to get to Cole. She was really the only person I'd trust with information like this, and that could help me figure out what I should do. Pause. Here's the problem. Why the doctor didn't tell her, okay, we could snatch some of your eggs out and you know, impregnate you that way? I don't understand. And she just let her leave beforehand. She didn't even try to offer her any options. What a raggedy asshole. Anyway, when we made it to the house, I didn't even wait for the driver to get out and open the door for me. My feet was already on the ground. I zoomed up to the front door and the security opened it for me. The first stop I made was Cole's room. I found her in there lying across the bed with her laptop and school books everywhere. I quickly closed the door behind me and rushed over to her bed. Coco noticed me and sat up, moving her things around where I can climb in bed with her. What's wrong? She asked. I just had a doctor's appointment. What happened? The doctor just basically told me there's no way in hell that I'll be able to have children. Oh, I'm so sorry, honey. Cole pulled me into her embrace and the warmth of her frame broke me. I could no longer hold in the tears I'd been fighting. To know that having children was taken away from me when I wasn't even sure if I wanted them in the first place bothered the fuck out of me. It hurt. What are you gonna do? That's the thing. I don't know. Pulling away from her, I stared her straight in the eyes and asked, what if they toss me to the side after they find out that I can't have children? I'm supposed to produce an heir. There's no way that they'd be understanding. Not a family like them. Law loves you. He might be understanding. I don't think he'd leave you just because you can't have kids, and God has the last say so. The doctor's going off their opinion. They can assume that you can't have kids, but only God can make that decision. If I were you, I'd just keep trying and see what happens, but not say anything to them about it. If the conversation comes up about it, handle it then. But for now, I don't think it's necessary to flat out tell them now when you don't really know yourself. What Coco was saying was making a lot of sense, but keeping a secret of this magnitude from law wasn't something that I was certain I wanted to do. Well, child, listen, they told my black ass at 17 I'd never have any children, but don't I have a grown ass one around here and didn't I pop out a set of twins too? The fuck? So, yeah, no. Anyway. For the past year, we've been truthful with each other, and if he found out that I'd been keeping a secret from him like this, there's no telling what it'd do to our relationship. You're worried about it, aren't you? Her eyes searched mine. I promise, everything's gonna be all right. Just pray about it. My phone chimed. Picking it up, I saw that it was a message from Law. I'll be late for dinner tonight. Go ahead without me. I'll make it up for later. Ever since Law and I got married, he made it his mission to keep me in the loop about what was going on so that I wouldn't worry. He was softening up a bit for me, but we still had a long way to go. What's for dinner tonight? I asked Coco. She lifted her eyes from her phone and replied, I don't know. You were staying for dinner? Yeah, to keep from eating alone tonight, I might as well. When dinner time rolled around, we all went downstairs for dinner. Soon as I stepped into the dining room, Ma's eyes lit up and she sprouted from her chair. Her arms wrapped around me so tightly as if she hadn't seen me in forever. Though I wasn't staying there anymore, I made sure to come by there at least once or twice a week to spend some time with her. Daddy was forever gone, and with Dash dead now, I knew it was kind of lonely for her being there all the time alone. To keep from being in the house so much, she'd picked up a shopping addiction. Ma was forever in a store somewhere, and she made sure to grab us something while she was out. If I was being honest, I think that's the real reason why Coco be there so much. I just love it when y'all come and visit me. We sat down at the table. The only person missing was Daddy. Where's Daddy? Coco took the words right out of my mouth. He said that he wasn't going to make it to dinner tonight because he had something he needed to take care of. Seems like everyone is busy tonight, I said, mumbling. Huh? Ma's gaze met mine. Nothing. After dinner, I said my goodbyes and made my way to the house in hopes that Law was there by the time I got there. And that's the end of that chapter. Child, these people be, ugh. Now she gonna, I'm telling y'all, I bet you this child gonna fuck around and not tell this man that she can't have no damn chillin. And then guess what's gonna happen? That nigga finna be pissed off. But she, because she gonna be done waited so long to tell him, you know? Ugh. Anyway, I'm picking up the book and ain't even got the timestamp yet. That's the horrible part. Like when you hide shit from them and they don't even know that you hiding shit, right? Like it's just all kinds of bullshit going on. So I don't know. I just feel like she shouldn't do it. It's not good. All right. I got my timestamp. So about 8 seconds. Chapter 11, Streets, a couple nights later. I've been out preparing shit for Coco's and my surprise date. Since I'd been hella busy lately with trying to prepare everything for the launch of Lilith, I'd been spending more time away from her. It was only right that I dedicated a night to her to let her know that she was still my number one priority. Anything that I was doing was to ensure security for us and generations to come. My truck pulled up to the house and I got out. Soon as I entered, I immediately began searching for Coco. I couldn't wait to see her face when we arrived at our destination. Not finding her on the first floor, I went upstairs to the bedroom, finding her in the bathroom with the scrub brush cleaning the shower. Bae, I called her name from the doorway so I wouldn't startle her. She turned the electric brush off, dropped it to the floor, and wiped her hand across her forehead before turning to face me. Hey, I didn't think you were coming in this early. Removing the rubber gloves, she sauntered in my direction, got on her tippy toes, and pecked me gently on the lips. That was enough for me. I missed her like crazy. Gripping her by the small of her back, I pulled her into my frame and shoved my tongue into her mouth. Coco's breath was minty fresh as if she just brushed her teeth prior to me entering the bathroom. I want you to toss on something. There's something I want to show you, I told her, figuring that if she'd been in here cleaning, she'd want a shower before we left the house. Where are we going? To dinner. Stepping to the mirror, she took in her reflection. Her hair was in a messy bun with a few pieces left out here and there. She had on one of my t-shirts and a pair of Calvin Klein boy shorts. How come you couldn't call and tell me this before you got here so that I can be more prepared? She turned around and faced me. My lips curved into a grin. Just throw on some jeans and a nice shirt. I promise, you don't have to do anything fancy. Streets, she whined, poking out her bottom lip, and I thought it was the cutest thing ever. Just keep it simple. You don't even have to do too much to your hair. Can you at least tell me where you're taking me? It's a surprise. Streets. Taking her by the hands, I pulled her towards me, pecked her softly on the center of the forehead and replied, take a shower, toss something on and I'll be waiting for you downstairs. I exited the bathroom to let her get ready and went downstairs to the living room. Since I told her that she didn't have to get fancy or anything, it shouldn't take her too long to get ready. About 40 minutes later, she came downstairs in a pair of denims and a white t-shirt. Her hair was now slicked back in a ponytail. Is this okay? She asked as she stopped in front of me and did a little twirl. Yeah, you're good. Pecking her on the temple, I took her by the hand and we exited the house. John already knew our destination, so I didn't have to tell him and ruin the surprise for Coco. We settled into the truck and I could feel Coco's eyes burning a hole in the side of my head. What? I questioned her with a grin. I really want to know where we're going for dinner that you have me dressed like this. I promise you won't love it. Stop worrying yourself. It took us no time to make it to the location. Coco turned and faced me. Her smile was larger than life. Really? Was the only thing that seemed to seep from her mouth. Yes. John opened the door for us. I got out first and helped her out. What was so secret about Waffle House? Take a look around the parking lot. She did as she was told. There were only a couple cars out there. I rented it out for you. I know how much you love Waffle House, so you can have all the food you desire and eat in peace. Babe, how hard she was grinning. I was certain her cheeks were burning by now. You really did that for me? Of course, I'd do anything to see that beautiful smile of yours. Some might have thought it was corny of me to rent out Waffle House when I could have just easily rented out an expensive restaurant, but it was all about putting a smile on my babe's face. I knew she would have preferred to eat here than somewhere that cost $100 a plate. If it was going to make her happy, I was going to do it. I love you so much. Getting on her tippy toes, she cupped my face and meshed our lips. We entered Waffle House, and I had it all decorated with balloons, candles, and rose petals. A single candle sat in the center of the table that we were going to eat at. I tried to make it as romantic as possible for her. Welcome to Waffle House. One of the waitresses greeted us at the door with a huge smile. As much money as I spent in here, that smile better not ever turn upside down as long as we were here. Thank you, Coco softly spoke back. I took her over to our table and we took a seat. Order whatever you want. You can have everything on the menu if you want. Coco craned her arm with mine and rested her temple against my shoulder. I really can't believe you did this. I'd do anything for you, babe. Without even looking at the menu, Coco turned to our waitress and said, I want the all-star, scrambled eggs with cheese, cheese grits, blueberry waffle with extra bacon. Then I want the cheeseburger with extra onions. Coming right up. And for you? The T-bone steak is fine. Nodding, she sauntered away from the table, leaving Coco and I alone. I got a surprise for you, I told her, and tapped her thigh for her to get up from the table. We stood to our feet, and I went over to the opposite side of the restaurant where I had a jukebox installed just for the night. There were so many songs placed on it. Most of them were Coco's favorite. Hitting the button, Coco Jones, I See You, began to play. Coco gasped. No, you didn't, she said, with her hand covering her mouth. I reached my hand in her direction, and she flew to me. I pulled her into my frame, and she melted straight into me. Pulling the same moves I learned for Law's wedding, we danced underneath the dim lights as they prepared our food. Being here with Coco, I never wanted this moment to end. And that's the end of that chapter. Why the fuck Law ain't doing shit like that for Honey? But I guess Coco and Streets got together, right, in a natural way, right? But Law and Honey, not so much. And plus, he was mean to her for the whole time, so fucking asshole. So here's that part. He is a fucking asshole. Hey, Naya, welcome. Thank you for being here. I appreciate you. All right. Did I miss anybody? Did I see you, Felicia? If I didn't, hey, girl, hey. Child, shit, I don't know. I don't know who I saw. I know I saw Nora. So I don't know, child. I don't know what the fuck, but whatever. Anyway, I have no idea. All I can do is try to make sure I speak to everybody, child, but like I said, if y'all don't say hey, child, I don't know. Chapter 12, Law, the following morning. A banging sound brought me from my deep sleep. Rubbing the sleep from my eyes, I reached over where Honey was supposed to be lying to find a cold, empty space. Shooting straight up in bed, my ears perked to see what the fuck that noise was that woke me, but I heard nothing. Seconds later, I heard voices coming from downstairs. Tossing the covers back, I climbed out of bed and grabbed my Versace robe off the back of the chair next to my side of the bed and slipped it on. As I tread toward the bedroom door, Honey's face came into view. Who's downstairs? I asked before she was able to say anything. Rubbing the back of her neck, her eyes darted to the floor, and she replied, your father. What I told you about not holding eye contact when talking to me, you want a spanking? The corner of her mouth quirked. I almost forgot who I was talking to. She got more pleasure out of spanking than she did pain. Her gaze synced with mine, and I asked, what did he want? Well, he's still down there, and he wants to speak with you right now. Said if you didn't come down soon, he was going to come up here and drag your ass from the bed. The fuck is his problem? I questioned nobody in particular and stepped around her to go see what the fuck he wanted this time of morning. When I made it downstairs, I found Pops standing in the living room with his hands shoved into his pockets. He wore a mug as he glowered at me. When the fuck did y'all plan on letting me know that your mama was still alive? How you know? I went by Streets' house this morning, and she was there. I just want to know how long have y'all been keeping this shit from me? I questioned him, and he acted as if the cat had his motherfucking tongue. So I'm asking you what the fuck going on. She ran into a room and locked the door, not wanting to talk to me. Somebody better give me some fucking answers and give me some now, because I buried my wife years ago, but somehow she's standing in the flesh now. Everyone was just as confused as you when she showed up. We've been found out that she was alive, but we've been keeping it on the hush for now. We aren't sure who tried to kill her and didn't want them to find out that she was still alive and come back and finish the job. Is that why you were questioning me about her death? I just know that you don't think I had something to do with that shit. I don't know what you had to do with anything. I closed in on him so that he can hear me loud and clear when I said this. But what I do know is that nothing else better not happen to her. The fuck you trying to say, boy? I chuckled at him calling me that. One thing he wasn't about to do was come in here and disrespect me in my own fucking home. I'm not a boy, I'm a man. And what I'm saying is, if you even think about harming a single hair on her head, I'll kill you dead myself. I warned him, meaning every word. Even after a year, I still wasn't certain if he was the one who called the hit on Ma, and that's the exact reason why he didn't know she was still alive. We'd been doing extremely well keeping her a secret till now. A grin overtook his face as he stared at me. You're growing balls, I can give you that, but you don't ever have to worry about me doing anything to your mama. That's my first love. I'd paint the city red behind her. In case you forgot, I did paint the city red. I'm just a little hurt that y'all keep this from me. Removing his hands from his pockets, he went over to the couch and took a seat. We did what we thought was best. That's what you always taught me, right? I guess so. Do you think you can get her to talk to me? I don't know about all that. I remembered how she didn't want him to know she was alive in the first place. No way she was going to sit down and talk with him willingly. Can you just fucking try? If you want to talk to her, you're going to have to figure that out yourself. Now, if you don't mind, I'm about to go take a shower so I can get my day started. Nodding, he stood to his feet. I took that as my cue to go back upstairs. As I approached the bedroom, I saw Honey in there in her black bra and thongs. She was fresh out the shower. Pops frustrated the fuck out of me, and I needed to release all this frustration before I went out into the world for the day. Meet me in the room, I told her, as I passed and entered the closet. And that's the end of that chapter. I'm about sick of this nigga. Every time he get frustrated with the world, he wanna beat bongos on her ass. No, God, that's not how that's supposed to work. I don't know what the fuck he doing, but this is bordering on abusive. This ain't even a lifestyle, because that's disrespectful as fuck. And it's irresponsible, because that's not what this is about. But okay, I don't mind my business about their dynamic, child. What works for them is for them. But still, I guess, you know, what they always say, your kink is not my kink. So, anyway, whatever. But whatever, even if your kink ain't my kink, you ain't supposed to be beating on that bitch like that. I tell you that much. Chapter 13, Coco. I stared at the flow application on my phone. 6 days late, take a pregnancy test. I'd never been in this situation before and wasn't certain what to do. My first thought was to call and tell Honey about it, but that thought was quickly replaced when I remembered how she told me that she couldn't have kids. The last thing I wanted to do was make her feel some type of way when I already knew she was going through it. So this was going to have to be something I dealt with on my own till I knew what was going on. It was said that your period could be late due to stress, and I'd been stressing hard with all the tests and stuff I'd been taking. Preparing for graduation. Yes, we were finally about to walk across that stage, and I couldn't wait. I'd already been looking into elementary schools that I wanted to work at once I got my degree. Closing out the application, I got up from the bed and grabbed my purse and shoes. If Flo said it was time for me to take a pregnancy test, then that's exactly what I was about to do. Not wanting to be seen, I decided to go to the dollar store and buy a test from there instead of taking my chances of going to Walmart or the drugstore. The last thing I wanted was for someone to catch me buying the test, and the news spread all over Montgomery before I was even able to take it and see if I was pregnant or not. Exiting the house, I approached the truck and my driver got out to open the door for me. Can you take me to the nearest dollar store? It didn't really matter which one I went to. They all sold tests. I just wanted to hurry up and get one and get back home. Nodding, he shut the door behind me and climbed into the driver's seat. My leg rapidly bounced as we rode to the store. I'd always wanted children, and if I was pregnant, this was a huge step for us. My driver took me to Dollar Tree. I went in the store and was immediately greeted by one of the cashiers. Shit, which never fucking happens. I don't know what fucking Dollar Tree she went to, but them bitches do not speak to you when you walk in. Child, look, they look irritated, like, here come this motherfucker. But anyway, hey, welcome to Dollar Tree, she said with a smile as I passed her register and headed to the feminine aisle. A lot of the store was empty, but they'd begun stocking the shelves with the Easter items. Stopping in front of the pregnancy test, I grabbed two of the cheap ones and went to the counter. If I was going to take a test, I wanted to take more than one to be certain of the results. Did you find everything you were looking for today? She asked me as I placed my belongings on the counter. Yup, I nodded and reached into my purse to grab my wallet. It was insane how I was about to swipe my black card because that was the only thing I carried on me. Honestly, I can't even remember the last time I had actual cash, especially after getting married to Streets. That man made sure I had everything I needed. Hell, I retired using the credit card that Daddy gave me. Shit, you stupid. Anyway, she handed me my bag and I exited the store. My driver opened the door of the truck for me and I told him, I'm going back home. He took me home and the entire ride to the house, my heart skipped beats in my chest. I could have sworn I felt it beating in my throat. Rushing into the house, I went straight to my bedroom and to the bathroom for privacy. One thing about Donna, she was always lurking somewhere, and if I was pregnant, I wanted Streets to be the first person to know. Ripping the box open, I saw that I needed to pee in a cup first to take the test. I don't know why I thought it was going to be as easy as peeing on a stick. Opening the door, I yelled out, Donna! It took her literally a couple of seconds to appear in the doorway as if she teleported there. Can you run downstairs and grab me a cup? Yes, ma'am, was her response, and she disappeared from the doorway. Pulling my phone from my purse, I went to my messages to see what Streets was up to. Maybe he could calm my nerves. So she sent him a text. What you doing? I'm just letting you know that I'm talking, or rather, sorry, thinking about you. That was half the truth. He wasted no time hitting me back with, I'm at the store right now. I was just about to ask if you wanted something for lunch. I can eat something. What do you have in mind? Donna cleared her throat behind me and I jumped. Quickly, I took the cup from her and shut the door in her face before she was able to see the test on the counter. Squatting over the toilet, I peed in the cup and dipped the stick into it. Once I was done, I washed my hands and stepped away from the counter. As I paced the bathroom floor, I fidgeted with my fingers, waiting for my results. All I can think about was how Streets was going to react if I was indeed pregnant. Checking my phone, I saw that it had been 2 minutes since I took the test. Normally, I would have read the instructions to see exactly how long I was supposed to wait, but my nerves were getting the best of me. I needed to know what the results were. Picking the stick up, I stared at the bold-ass line and faint one next to it. My mouth touched the counter. I was excited to see that I was with child, but worried at the same time. Honey has been trying nonstop to get pregnant and fulfill her contract, and here I was pregnant and wasn't even trying. It was crazy how life was. The chiming of my phone brought me from my thoughts. Picking it up, I saw that it was Streets texting me back. Whatever you want to eat, I'll be there in about 40 minutes. My heart fell to my feet. He was on his way to me, and I had to share the news of me being pregnant with him. I couldn't wait till he got here. Nibbling on my thumbnail, I debated on how exactly I was going to tell him I was pregnant. Then an idea hit me. Donna, I called, and she wasted no time making it to me. Yes, she answered. I know it's probably a long shot, but do you think there's any gift bags around the house? I need one, and I don't have time to go to the store. I can go check for you, she said, and exited the bedroom. The pacing began again. For whatever reason, I couldn't be still. Having this news sitting on my heart was killing me. I wanted so desperately to call and let Honey know, but I wasn't sure how she was going to feel about it. Donna came back into the room with a small white and blue folded up gift bag. This was all I can find. I'm not sure if it's too small for you. It's perfect. Thank you. I took the bag from her and she left the room. Shit, that's what you think. Call the bitch again and see them pop up like a nigga in the box. Once I placed the test in the bag, I went downstairs to the living room to wait for Streets to arrive. Baby, I promise it wasn't even 30 minutes later and that man was walking through the front door. I sprouted to my feet and ran over to the door, not giving him time to get in the house good. He jumped soon as he bumped right into me. Almost knocked your little ass down, he said, gripping me by the forearms. The smile on my face was so huge that my cheeks burned. I got something for you. What? I'm not gonna tell you, silly. Here, open it. I gave him the gift bag and bounced on my tippy toes, waiting for him to open it. Streets opened the gift bag and pulled the test out. Is this for real? His eyes searched mine for answers. Yeah, I wouldn't play about something like that. Streets swooped me up into his arms and swung me around. His lips embraced my temple before planting me back on my feet. I'm really about to be a father? Tears filled the brims of his eyes. I knew that once he found out that he'd probably be excited, but what I didn't know was that it'd bring tears to his eyes. Yes, he kissed me on the center of the forehead, then the tip of my nose before his lips found mine. We got a reason to celebrate now. I'm taking you wherever you want to go for lunch. It don't matter if it's out the city, we going. That's one of the many reasons why I love this man. And that's the end of that chapter. Child, listen. My God, today. All right. Not her slow ass like it. Jaleesa. Oh, my God. You a cold piece of work, ain't it? Now she's slow. Good googly moogly. Lord have mercy. Hey, Buns. Welcome back, child. We've been here for about an hour and something. I don't know what time you got here. Oh, about 5 minutes ago. So, yeah, about an hour and 8 minutes. Hey, Miss Pretty. Welcome back, boo. Thank you for being here. All right. Let me get this next timestamp, child. Okay. All right, I put it out a little bit. Y'all so silly. Once this thing count down, I'm gonna start back. I set it out a little bit so I can, what you call it. Oh, so you must not have your notifications on IG. Chapter 14, Marsha Williams. Why does this whore have a chapter in the book? Okay. I'd been reaching out to law and not getting a response. His father had banned me from his estate. I couldn't step foot on there and speak with anyone. Since law always came to my house or had me meet him at a hotel, I didn't know where he lived. The security wouldn't let me step foot onto the dealership parking lot after the scene I caused there the last time. It was frustrating. All I wanted was to talk to them and let them know what was going on, but no one wanted anything to do with me. I couldn't go to Honey or Coco because they already blocked the fuck out of me. School had been a thing of the past the last year of my life because I had to focus on other things. Plus, I wasn't making the money for tuition like I was before with law. Had I known fucking with Mr. Blanco was going to get me completely cut off and I'd have to fend for myself, I wouldn't have done it. Now I was ass out and trying to figure out what I was going to do next. As I sat on my ass, a plan came to mind and I began to put it in motion. Since I wasn't allowed on the premises, I sat across the street from the dealership the entire day and waited for Law to leave. His truck pulled out of the parking lot and I followed behind it. Law didn't drive too long before the truck pulled over to the side of the road and he exited. My eyes expanded, knowing that I wasn't discreet and he'd figured out I was following him. Stopping behind the truck, I placed my car in park and got out. "Why the fuck you following me, Marcia?" he calmly asked, with his hands shoved into his pockets. Slamming the door behind me, I stepped in front of the car, not wanting to get hit by traffic. "Shit, too bad. Sorry," as they sped past me. "I've been trying to reach you. For what? I had your baby." "Man, fuck out of here." Law spun on his heels to walk off, and I rushed over to the passenger side of the car and pulled the baby seat out. "I'm serious, Law. I had your baby, and it's about time that you helped me with it," I said, and rushed behind him. "See?" I stopped at the back bumper of his truck with the car seat in my hand. Sorry. Spider was on me. Okay. A blue blanket covered the seat. "I'm not going to keep raising this baby by myself. If you don't help me, I'm going to put you on child support." Law stopped in his tracks with his back facing me. "Every time we fucked, we used a condom. There's no fucking way you had a baby by me. The condom could have popped. I don't know, but this baby is here. You're the only person I've been sleeping with. You can do a DNA test if you want, but this baby is yours. I even named it Lawrence Jr." "Bitch, you lost your fucking mind." Law faced me with a scowl. His eyes went down to the car seat that I had securely in my hand. "You want to see him? He looks just like you." I offered him a smile, but his face didn't even crack. "That's not my fucking child. I don't know what type of fucking games you trying to play, but you're asking to lose your fucking life. The only seat I'm going to have is the one that Honey pushes out. That's the only motherfucker I've been bussing down raw. Don't fucking play with me." With that being said, he gripped the handle on the truck and opened the door. "Fine, I'm serving your ass with child support papers," I yelled at his back, and he climbed into the truck and shut the door behind him. I stood there, still holding my baby's car seat as he pulled away from the curb. "Fucking bastard," I said, and trekked back to my car. Since he wanted to play with me, I was heading straight to the library and print out the child support paperwork and send that shit in. They were about to serve his stupid ass since he didn't want to sit and listen to me. We'll see if Honey produces his dumb ass a child once she finds out that he already has one by me. After placing the baby in the car, I hopped into the driver's seat and hit up Clarence. He was supposed to have done some paperwork for me, and I wanted to make sure it was ready for pickup. "Hey, Marcia, I was just about to call you." "So that means my stuff ready, right?" "Hell yeah. It was a little harder to accomplish, but I got it done. I'm on my way to come get it right now. Do you mind if I use your printer right quick so that I can print off something? It'll save me making a trip to the library." "Guess so. I don't have a color ink, though." "That's fine." Disconnecting the call, I went straight to Clarence's house. When I got there, he was sitting on the porch, smoking a blunt. Getting out the car, I approached him on the porch. "God damn, every time I see you, it's like you're getting finer and finer." "Clarence gone. I ain't here for all that. Where's your computer and printer?" Getting up from his seat, he ashed the blunt out on the brick wall and tucked it behind his ear. We stepped into the house, and he led me over to the dining room table and sat down in the chair directly in front of the computer. "I'm going to pull the browser up for you. I don't need you going through shit. Just print whatever you need to print and get the fuck up. It's confidential stuff on here. It's for my eyes only." "Nigga, ain't nobody worried about the porn you be watching on this computer. Move." I shoved him out the seat and sat down myself. I went to Google to search up the paperwork to file for child support and printed it off. "Where's my paperwork anyway?" I asked him as I heard the printer going behind me. "Right here." He slipped an envelope on the table in front of me and said, "You really think this shit gonna work?" "It has to. What other choice do I have?" And that's the end of that chapter. Whoo, child. I don't think it's now one of their babies, but if it's anybody's baby, I would think it was his daddy's baby. I don't think the brother fucked him though. I mean her. I don't think the brother slept with her. But I know that Law did. But I mean, he was allegedly, you know, all rubbered up or whatever. So I don't know. But y'all, this is crazy. I'm just like, what the hell? Oh, man. I hope not, child. I don't think we're going to be stressed. Because then it just came. You read it already, Naya. Damn, it just came out the other day, according to the child. I don't know. But, okay, wait, what you say? Where'd I just see it at? Okay, Jazzy says she broke, no friends. She need a way in, probably. So Danielle said, no, I'm saying the baby better be Law's brother. Not his. Oh, okay, right. Right. Better be his baby and not his son. Mm-mm. Yeah, I think she lying too. I hope so, Demetria, because what the fuck paperwork does she have that fuck knuckle ass nigga print out? This hoe is lying. I hope honey don't fucking fall for the banana in the tailpipe with her slow bopping ass. I don't know, she fucking, Wait a minute, she said, I did. I couldn't help myself, but I needed to hear Saki's version. So did I really read it? A girl. Oh my God. I'm mad. Now you might as well just, no, don't tell us. Don't say nothing. Oh, Lord. Damn, I hate when it be somebody around me that's done read something or saw something because I'd be tempted to ask, like, what's going to happen, goddammit? Okay, let me shut up and get the timestamp, child. I'm so fucking annoyed. Why did Law even fuck that girl anymore? And why would the baby, what the fuck kind of baby is this she got? Because it's been over a year. So what the fuck? Like, how does she got a baby that's that big? I mean, still in a little car seat that she could snatch out the back. Fuck out of here, ho. Chapter 15, honey, a week later. She said, I ain't telling you shit. Let's read this damn book. Okay. Daddy had sent out a text to me and Coco stating that he wanted us to come to dinner tonight. I thought it was strange since he didn't really communicate with us like that. There was no telling why he was summoning us, and that was the exact reason why I was going. I was nosy as fuck. Law agreed to go over there with me. After all, it was family dinner, and he was now part of the family, even though it says no. It's supposed to be now. Yeah, but I know I'd be right. So anyway. And she put apart, as in, you know, falling apart or whatever. So I don't know, but that's not what it is. So anyway, fuck up. All right. The bathroom door opened and steam seeped out into the bedroom. Seconds later, Law exited, wrapped in a towel. It took everything in me not to get up from this vanity and rip that towel from around his waist. It was already going on 5:30 and Daddy wanted us to be at the house by 6. No way we were going to be there on time when neither one of us were dressed yet. A few minutes late wouldn't hurt anybody. Law removed the towel, displaying his dick. That man knew exactly what the hell he was doing, nipping my lower lip. I spun around on the bench and went back to applying my makeup. My pussy danced in my panties, but for now, I was going to have to ignore her ass. By the time I was done doing my makeup, Law was fully dressed in these black slacks and burgundy Burberry shirt. You look so handsome, I told him as I got up from the vanity. Don't you think that you need to be getting dressed? We're going to be late. A few minutes won't hurt anybody. It's not going to take me long. My clothes right there, I replied, pointing over at the bed. I'll be downstairs waiting for you, he said, and exited the bedroom. I went on and tossed on my black mini dress and slipped my feet into my red bottoms. Hitting my body with my Versace perfume, I grabbed my purse and left out of the bedroom. We were just going to dinner at my parents' house, so I wasn't about to go all out with my outfit. Something simple and classy was just fine for me. When I made it downstairs, Law was in the living room tossing back something brown in a glass. I'm ready, I made known, and we both headed out the door. We made it to my parents' house, and from the looks of things, everyone else was already there. The security opened the door for us, and I led Law toward the dining room. Over the past year, we didn't spend much time with my family outside of holidays and occasional dinners. Daddy was always too busy for anything anyway. Hey, y'all, I spoke, Soon as I entered the dining room, Daddy was sitting in his normal seat at the head of the table with Ma right next to him. Coco and Streets sat opposite of her, so we went over and took the seats alongside Ma. "You're late," was the only thing that seeped from Daddy's lips, the look of disgust evident on his face. He didn't have to say anything to let me know that he was disappointed in me at the moment. Hell, I ain't really give a shit. Though things worked out greatly between Law and I, he still wasn't my favorite person till this day. I pecked Ma on the cheek. Coco sat across from us, face glowing as if she just got a fresh facial. What the fuck? Why is that so hard to say? Fresh facial. Motherfucker. You're glowing, Co. Her hand covered Streets's, and their gaze lingered. That's what happens when you have a good man taking care of you. Streets kissed her on the corner of the mouth. Now that everyone's finally here, I can tell y'all the news that I've been holding in. I'm running for re-election, Daddy blurted, as if he hated that all the attention wasn't on him. That's great, Ma spoke up. She seemed to be the only one in this room that gave a fuck. That little news he could have kept to himself. Him running for re-election only meant that he was going to be more busy than he already was, taking away valuable time from Ma. She already sat in his big-ass house alone most days. I kind of felt sorry for her. No way that man was that fucking busy to spend some time with her. You really called us here to tell us something that we already figured? I asked him and grabbed the wine out the chiller and poured myself a glass. If I was about to sit here and deal with his antics, I was going to have to be a little intoxicated. The only thing Daddy really cared about was power. As long as he had that, he was straight. Honey, don't talk to your father like that, Ma told me and cut her eyes at me. I took a sip of my wine to keep from responding. She can be happy for his ass all she wanted, but I can care less. Let us know if you need anything, Street spoke up, and I was appalled. The only reason why they wanted to keep his stupid ass in office was so that they can have the governor in their back pocket. They forced Daddy to do whatever he wanted when they wanted. What? Whatever he wanted when they wanted? But that's what it say. At least some people are happy for me, unlike my daughter. His slick remark didn't even move me. While we're announcing something, there's something that Streets and I would like to announce. I'm pregnant, Coco said, catching everyone off guard, especially me. I would have thought I'd be the first to know something like that. Normally, she'd call and tell me news first, but here I was finding out with everyone else. Ever since she married Streets, it was as if we weren't as close as we were before. I felt like he was replacing me, and I wasn't sure how to feel about that. Her being pregnant kind of made me feel some type of way, knowing that I'd been trying to get pregnant myself to fulfill my contract. I damn sure didn't think she'd get pregnant before me, before I found out that I couldn't have children. The more I tried, the more I felt as if the doctor was right. I gulped down the remainder of my wine and poured myself another glass. Congratulations! Ma's hands pressed against her widespread lips as her eyes glimmered, looking over at Coco. Having grandchildren was something she always wanted, so to know that Coco was about to provide her with just that made her entire night. Coco would be lucky if she was able to keep her own baby because Ma was for sure gonna steal it. Coco's gaze met mine and I offered her a faint smile. I was happy for my sister, no doubt, but it hurt that I wasn't in her position. Dinner went on as planned. Once it was over, we all said our goodbyes and left the house. The ride back home was a silent one. Along the way, we stopped at the 24-hour Walgreens on Atlanta Highway. Turning to Law, I asked, "You must need something out of there." "Yeah, a pregnancy test," was his answer. "Huh? You heard me right. You about to take a test." And that's the end of that chapter. Oh, shit. Here we go. Well, I'm glad you didn't know, Danielle. Oh, my God. Oh, so she probably had him make up some fake, print up some fake paternity papers. Yeah, but that's, she can't know. That's got to come from somewhere else. She can't, how the fuck would she say that she got his DNA to test it against? You know, that's got, he got a, she can't say it came to her. And he need to order the shit, not her bitch ass, with her stupid ass. That daddy is having an affair. He's the pappy of that baby boss. Let me get this fucking timestamp, child, because y'all ain't about to worry me. Oh, my God, today. Listen, Linda. I know what you're trying to do. Go on now. Don't blow that shit in my face. That's not cool. Man, stay trying to get a nigga fucked up. No God. All right. Chapter 16, Law. After that shit happened with Marsha, I'd been thinking heavily about Honey and how she hadn't popped up pregnant yet. Tonight added the icing on the cake. Coco was pregnant, but Honey hadn't said anything to me about her being with child. We'd been fucking like jackrabbits, and she wasn't carrying a seed yet. Something wasn't right. Pops was gonna be looking for her to pop up with a child soon, so we had to figure this shit out. I don't have a need to take a pregnancy test, she protested. I haven't heard you say anything about taking one or nothing. You know that we have to produce an heir soon. Okay, I understand that, but if I'm not pregnant, I don't know what you want me to do. I can't just hit my stomach and magically make a baby pop up in there. Let's just take the test, then we'll go from there. I just said there's no need, Law. I know I'm not pregnant. My period isn't late or anything. I'll be back, I told her, and shut the door behind me. I wanted to take her word for it, but I needed to see with my own eyes that she wasn't pregnant. After that, we can figure out what needs to be done to get her to that point. I went into the store and went straight to the feminine aisle. I grabbed a clear blue test because I'd heard they were great and went straight to the register. An older woman was in line in front of me. She searched her purse while the cashier stood there with her hand on her hip. I'm sorry, I really thought it was in here. I don't think I'll be able to get it. Can you just cancel it? From what I can see, she really didn't have much, just a few snacks and hygiene products. Digging into my pocket, I pulled out my wallet and placed my test on the counter. Ring that up with her stuff and I'll pay for it. The older woman's head snapped in my direction. She had a head full of gray hair and a face full of wrinkles, the top of her back slightly hunched. What the hell was she doing out this time of night alone? You really don't have to do that. I promise I have money. I just forgot my wallet in my other purse. It's fine. I want to. Opening my wallet, I pulled out my card. You're such a gentleman. Thank you so much. You're welcome. The cashier rang up my test and handed it back to me. Whoever you're buying that for, I hope God blesses him with a baby. Me too, I thought. Thanks. Let me help you with your bags. I grabbed all of our things and walked her out the door. She only had a couple bags, and I was certain she'd be able to manage on her own, but I knew the city all too well. Fuck niggas preyed on people like her. I just wanted to make sure she made it to her vehicle safely. After I walked her to her truck, I placed her bags on the back seat. Thank you. She offered me a smile and climbed into her truck. I stood there and waited till she backed out of parking space, then went back to my truck. That was nice of you, Honey said when I got into the truck. Ignoring her, I placed the test in her lap. She opened the bag and quickly folded it back up. I literally just told you before you went in there that I didn't need a test. You're so fucking hard-headed. We're going home, I told Frederick. The remainder of the ride to the house was silent. Honey had an attitude because I was going against her word, but she needed to understand that there was a lot riding on her becoming pregnant. When we got home, she climbed out the truck and slammed the door behind her. She didn't even wait for me to get out before she entered the house, leaving the front door wide open. I followed behind her upstairs to the bedroom. She tossed the test in the trash in the bathroom, and I went in behind her to grab it. Why are you acting like a brat? Stopping in her tracks, she spun around and faced me. Brat! An evil laugh seeped from her lips. Brat! Lower your tone when speaking to me, or else what? My teeth clenched. She was really pushing boundaries right now. Fine was the only thing I said before entering the closet. I stepped into the red room and grabbed the thickest paddle off the wall. When I went back into the room, I sat on the bench at the foot of the bed, my gaze locked with hers. I ain't even have to speak. Honey was already on her way in my direction, hugging herself. She lay over my lap, and my fingertips coursed the back of hers as I lifted her dress over her hips. Tightly clutching the paddle, I lifted it into the air and brought it down on her ass, leaving nothing but redness. She flinched, but nothing escaped her lips. You want to be tough? Count these fucking licks. Wham! I hit her again, and she didn't say nothing. You disobeying me now? I said count them. Don't make me start back over from the top. Wham! One, Honey spoke. Wham! Two, wham! Three. Dropping the paddle to the floor, I traced the redness of her ass with my index finger. I lifted Honey by the lips, where her ass was directly in my face and my lips embraced the mark. You gonna go in the bathroom and take that test so I can see for myself that you're not pregnant. If you're not, then we'll figure out where to go from there, I told her, and released her. Honey got up and went into the bathroom. I sat there on the bench waiting to see what her results was. It bothered the fuck out of me that Marcia was trying to pin a baby on me. In my heart, I knew that baby wasn't mine, but there was still this little voice in the back of my mind wondering if it was. If Honey couldn't produce an heir and that baby was indeed mine, there was no telling what the hell Pops was gonna do. Honey exited the bathroom with the test in her hand and approached me. Here was the only thing she said. I held the negative test in my hand and asked, "Do you know how come you're not pregnant yet? I don't think there's anything wrong with my semen, but I'll make an appointment and make sure that I'm able to have children." It probably would have been smart to let her know about Marcia, but I didn't think it was best to bring that up in the situation at the moment. "Did you really think all of that's necessary? I just want to check all the boxes. Pops ain't gonna fully be off my back till I can prove to him that I have an heir on the way. That's the only thing that's stopping me from fully taking over. I'll get on that first thing in the morning. I think I'm going to be gone and get ready for bed," Honey said, and went into the bathroom, shutting the door behind her. I could sense she felt some type of way, but I knew Pops and I was willing to do whatever possible to make sure nothing came between our marriage. My phone chimed. Pulling it from my pocket, I saw that it was TP hitting my line. The truck that was supposed to come in tonight never showed. I called the driver multiple times and got no answer. I reached out to my cop friend and have them searching for it. I'll let you know something soon as I find out. And that's the end of that chapter. Oh, I don't understand this. Why is he even thinking, child? Naya, is he the pappy? That's all I need to know. She talking, I ain't telling you shit. Let me get this time stamp. Lord have mercy. I am so annoyed, y'all. Because, like, why the fuck? I don't even, anyway. This girl, he should have broke her fucking neck. When he found out she was fucking his daddy, her neck should have been broken immediately, if not fucking sooner. I just don't understand. Mm-mm. All right. 5 seconds, y'all. Chapter 17, Streets, a couple days later. "Have you told your daddy about y'all having a baby?" Ma asked as she sat at the dining room table. We were all having breakfast before I got the day started. Ma had been living with us for the past year till we decided where we wanted to place her. Law and I were going to get her a house, but we also wanted to make sure she was going to be safe in it. We still weren't certain who actually tried to kill her. To this day, Ma was still adamant that it was Pops. Pops had finally found out that Ma was still alive, and he'd been blowing my phone up, trying to get in contact with her, but she doesn't want anything to do with him. I haven't really gotten around to telling him yet. Deep down, I didn't really want to just yet because I was the first to produce an heir and Law Nim was still trying. The last thing I wanted was for Pops to try and force me to take over. "We'll get around to it," Coco said as her hand covered mine. "Sir, your father's outside," Donna said from the doorway. Getting up from my seat, I excused myself from the table to go see what he wanted before he was able to get into the house. Ma was in there, and I was certain that she didn't want anything to do with him. Pops ain't never show up to my house that much. He had been here, looking for her. I opened the front door and saw Pops directing a fucking tow truck into the driveway with a brand new Bentley on the back of it. Pouring from the windows were red and pink balloons and roses as if it was Valentine's Day or something. "What are you doing?" I asked him, and he jumped at the sound of my voice. Pops faced me with a smile bigger than the sun on his face. I hadn't seen him smile this hard since before Ma's so-called death. "I'm here to see your mother. Go get her right quick." He tossed over his shoulder and stepped back as the tow truck came to a halt. "I don't think she wants to see you. I've been telling you this every time you call." This man had been calling my damn phone so much that I began letting his calls roll over to voicemail. If it was something important, he'd reach Law and Law would contact me. The shit was too much to deal with. "Do what the fuck I said," he said as the driver got out the truck and went to release the car. Going back into the house, I went to the dining room where Ma and Coco were still sitting at the table. "What did he want?" Ma asked, taking a bite of her biscuit. "He wants to speak to you." Ma's eyes darted in my direction. "I don't want to talk to him," she quickly replied. "I already told him that, but I don't think he's leaving without talking to you. Call the police on his ass or something." Ma, now you know, fine, I'll get rid of his ass, she said, and got up from her seat. She stormed toward the front of the house with me on her trail. Coco wasn't too far behind me. Of course, she was about to come and be nosy. Shouldn't you be getting ready for class? I asked her as we stopped at the front door. Ma stepped out onto the porch with her right hand resting on her hip. I will in a bit, Coco replied. Clyde, what the hell do you want? Ma questioned Pops, and he stepped to the porch, lips spread from ear to ear. I brought you something. I don't want it, she said, before he was able to tell her what it was. You used to love my gifts. Key word is used to. I don't want nothing from you, Clyde. Can you just leave and stop harassing me before I go to the police? And what are you going to tell them, huh? That you faked your own death and now you back among the living? And your husband won't leave you alone because he missed you so much? Do you have to be an ass? It's the truth, though, right? All I'm doing is trying to get my wife back. I've been so miserable without you. Then maybe you should have thought about that before you tried to have me killed. Pops placed his hand on his hip and his head cocked to the side. Zara, where you get this crazy-ass idea from? Why the hell would I try to kill you? So you want to stand there in my face and pretend like you don't remember? You don't remember when I tried to leave that you told me out your own mouth you'd kill me? You don't remember paying someone to take my fucking life? Now you want to come up over here because you find out that I'm still alive by mistake and think that you gonna win me back because you bought me a fucking car and some flowers? I don't want that shit. Do you not know how many sympathy gifts you gave me over the years after you did something you weren't supposed to and I forgave you? I'm not forgiving you for trying to take my life. Shit, you basically did. I've lost so many years with my kids that I can't get back because of you. Zara, Pop stepped toward her. And she backed away with her hands up in surrender. No, just go, she said, and went back into the house. Coco went behind her, probably to check on her. I shut the front door and Pops approached me. I really don't know where she gets those crazy ass ideas from. I never tried to kill her. Yeah, I may have told her that if she ever left, I'd kill her. But what man hasn't? When you love your woman as much as I loved mine, you wouldn't want to lose them. Maybe she just needs time, Pops, I lied, knowing that Mom was stubborn and wasn't about to give in to his bullshit. Her mind was made up that she wanted nothing to do with him, and she wasn't going to deal with him. Who could blame her, though? She had said in her mind that he ruined her life. I wouldn't want anything to do with his ass either if I was her. I'm going to leave the car here in case she changes her mind. Here. He handed me the set of keys. I was going to have the car moved to the garage where it'd more than likely collect dust because Mom wasn't about to take that shit. I'm going to keep trying. I'm not just going to walk away from my woman like that. Do what you got to do, Pops, I told him and stood there as he climbed into his truck and it pulled out the driveway. How we know that when she tried to crank it up, the bitch didn't blow up like in that fucking movie Casino. Shit. Law and I really had to figure out the truth behind Ma's murder so that we all could move on from this shit. Just as I stepped back into the house, my phone chimed. It was a text from Law. The driver just turned up dead. Meet me at the dealership. And that's the end of that chapter. You feel like they mama lying? Oh, Lord. Naya, is the mama lying? I need to know if the mama lying. You can at least tell me if the damn mama lying, girl. That's just a little something. Just tell me if the bitch lying or not. You can tell me if or not she lying. Hell, that's just a little something. All right, I ain't gonna be your fucking friend then. Cool. It's all good. Chapter 18, Coco, Spring Break. Honey and I decided to get away for a while before graduation to enjoy ourselves. We ended up at Ocean Reef. It was this bomb-ass island with an even doper resort. Literally everything we needed was right here. We didn't have to leave for anything. We'd been here for a couple days now, and Honey and I spent most of our time at the spa. It was much needed after all the stress of studying we'd been doing. Tonight, we decided that we were going to go out to this nightclub here. Really, it was Honey's idea, and I just went along with it because no way in hell she was about to go alone. Since I was pregnant and didn't really drink anyway, I can keep an eye out for everything and make sure we made it back to our suite safely. Honey had been tossing back shot after shot ever since she woke up this afternoon. I'd asked her several times if she was all right, and she kept saying she was, but I could sense something was bothering her. "You sure you're good?" I asked her for the millionth time as she took a swig from the Remy bottle in the living room of the suite. The way she was already staggering, I ain't feel like we needed to go to the club. I thought about suggesting that we stayed in tonight, but I didn't want to end up pissing her off. "How many times are you going to ask me that question?" Honey cut her eyes in my direction and placed the bottle on the coffee table. "As many times as I need to, I just want to make sure that you're okay. And I keep telling you that I am," she said and grabbed her clutch. "Now, can you come on so we can go?" I stood there and watched her stagger toward the door. No way in hell I was about to allow her to leave this room and go to a club filled with strangers already drunk off her ass. She'd just have to hate me later. I jumped in front of the door blocking her. "What the hell are you doing?" "Honey, you're drunk. I don't think it's a good idea to go to the club tonight. How about we just stay in?" "Are you fucking serious?" "Yes. Look how you're acting. We can try the club another time." Gripping her by the shoulders, I backed her away from the door. "You're really trying to stop me from having fun." "No, I'm not. I'm trying to keep both of us safe. I don't think you should leave here drunk like that. Just go take a nap. You'll feel better when you wake back up." I took her to the bedroom and pulled the covers back on her bed. Guiding her over to it, she sat down. I kneeled and slipped her shoes off her feet. Honey lay down underneath the covers and I went to leave, but she stopped me. "Can you lay down with me? I don't want to be alone right now." "Sure." Lifting the covers, I slipped in behind her, being the big spoon. "I don't know what to do." "What do you mean?" "Law made me take a pregnancy test. I had the chance to tell him that I can't have children, but I didn't. He thinks that he's the problem. Sorry. He's trying to go see a doctor to see if something's wrong with his sperm. Not with her sperm. It says her sperm, but it's his sperm. If they tell him that there's nothing wrong with it, he'll know that I'm the issue. Well, if you feel that much about it, try talking to him. He might be understanding. You never know. It's not really him. It's their father. He's worried about what he'd think if we don't produce a child soon. It's so much pressure and stress. All we do is fuck. Just try talking to him, honey. It'll take most of the stress off you. We'll see. After laying there with her for a while, I heard her snoring. I slipped out of the bed and pulled the door up behind me. I felt terrible that I was pregnant and she was the one being pressured to have children. Going into the living room, I grabbed my phone and called Law. I wasn't about to tell him anything about what we talked about, but maybe if I warned him that there was something they needed to talk about, he'd ignite the conversation and it'd be much easier for Honey to talk to him about it. The phone rang for a while and I thought it was going to roll over to the voicemail. Suddenly, the line picked up and I heard Law's voice. "Everything good? Y'all straight?" "We're fine," I snickered. "Then why you calling my phone in the middle of the night? You had me ready to catch the fucking jet thinking some shit was wrong." "I totally forgot about the time difference, but I was calling because you really need to talk to Honey. It's a conversation that y'all two need to have, and it's driving her crazy. She's scared to talk to you about it, so I figured if I told you that y'all needed to talk, she'd come out and tell you what's going on." "What is it?" "I don't think it's my place to tell. I'm already overstepping boundaries, telling you to talk to her." "Okay." We ended the call, and I went into my room to lay down and watch TV. Like he ain't gonna just call her and say, "Hey, your sister called me." Oh my God, what the fuck? Oh my God, today I am the fuck over it, bro. Like, I don't even know what to think, y'all. I'm so fucking annoyed. Y'all just All right, let me get this next timestamp. Hold on, y'all. All right. All right, I got it. Just let it count down. Hold on, y'all. Good googly moogly. All right, y'all. It's almost done. Like 8 seconds. Chapter 19, Honey, sometime the following day. Yawning, I rubbed my eyes with my palms as I lay there in the bed. I ain't know what time it was or how long I'd been asleep. About time you woke up. I shot straight up in bed at the sound of Law's voice. This nigga done came here. Yo! OMG! My eyes landed on him as he sat on the couch on the opposite side of the room. What are you doing here? When did you get here? This morning? This morning? What time is it? Going on to? Are you serious? Lifting the covers and pillow, I searched the bed for my phone but couldn't locate it. What made you show up here? I got a call from Coco last night. My eyes expanded because there was no telling what she told him. A call about what? My heart banged against my chest. Please don't let her been done told him what I think she told him. She was concerned about you, so I hopped on a jet to come see what was going on. Is there something that you need to tell me? I nibbled on the corner of my lower lip. There might not have been a lot that I remembered from the night before, but I do know that I regretted not telling him about me not being able to have kids and knew that it was something I needed to get off my chest if I was going to feel better. There is something that I wanted to talk to you about, but I just didn't know how you were going to respond. I'm your husband. You shouldn't be scared to come to me about anything. This right here is on another level. You know you had me take that pregnancy test, and I told you that I didn't need it because I wasn't pregnant. Well, I know how much we'd been having sex, and I hadn't come up pregnant yet, so I went to the doctor and found out that I can't even have kids. I know. What you mean you know? Honey, I own Montgomery. There's nothing in the city that you can do that I don't know about. I was just wondering exactly how long you were going to take to tell me. So you let me drive myself crazy for no reason? When I mentioned going to the doctor myself, I thought you'd open your mouth and tell me then, but you didn't. Wait, so that means you knew when you had her take the test, bitch nigga. Oh, my God. Hey, little mama. Welcome, boo. Thank you for being here, lovey. I appreciate you. I'm so mad at this pimp named Slickback. Oh, my God. What the fuck? I'm sitting here, y'all, pissed off because I'm trying to figure out how this fucker's gonna work out. So you're not mad at me? Why would I be? Because I can't have kids. You don't think that you wasted your time marrying me? Hell no. If you can't have kids, then we'll figure some shit out. We'll try doctors first, and if that doesn't work, then we might have to look into having a surrogate. You're willing to do all of that for me? Why wouldn't I? When we got married, we became a fucking team. At first, it was to please Pops, but I fell for you. There's no me without you. This shit is till death do us part. For better or for worse, we gonna figure it out. Okay, now you need to tell her about that motherfucking bitch. Getting up from bed, I went over to where Law sat and straddled him. I'm really glad y'all kidnapped us. If you hadn't, I would have never met you. I can't see my life without you. Craning my arms around his neck, I meshed our lips. This man was my better half. It was a struggle at first, but I swear I wouldn't trade him for anything in the world. Girl, I'm so fucking mad. I'm so... Oh, my God. Y'all, you know what? This is not the place for this conversation. Because Okay. I am the fuck annoyed at him just popping his ass up there, looking like Billy Goat's Gruff sitting in the goddamn chair. Child, listen. Oh, all right. Later that day, turns out Law wasn't the only one who hopped on that jet and came here. Streets tagged along with him. We all spent the day together shopping and enjoying good food. When we made it back to the suite, we parted ways. Law and I went into the bedroom to get ready for the night. We were taking a private yacht out for a couple days. I was nervous about it because I'd never stayed out on a yacht for that long. Sure, I've been on several cruise ships, but they were much larger than a yacht. It was Law's idea to go out. I think she meant and relax without anyone else being around us. Child, so he could drown your ass. Sorry. I didn't mind, though, because the only thing on my mind was nobody was going to be able to hear my screams once we were out in the middle of the ocean. Though I hadn't been away from Law that long, I missed the hell out of my man. I'd grown so attached to him that I wanted to be underneath him 24/7. Of course, when I felt he needed his space, I kept my distance, but my favorite place in the entire world was next to him. You ain't got to take too much clothes. You gonna be naked most of the time, Law said over his shoulder as I went through my shopping bags in search of what I wanted to take with me. We finished packing and met Streets and Coco in the living room. I'm so excited, Coco said as she grabbed her purse off the coffee table. Streets picked up their bags and we all headed for the door. Our girls' trip quickly turned into vacation real quick, and I wasn't even mad at it. It didn't take us long to make it to the yacht. Soon as we boarded, Law made it known that we needed to prepare for dinner that was waiting for us on the top deck. He and Streets had everything planned out for the next couple of days, which took the weight off our shoulders of having to figure out what we were going to do. Coco and I had come to Ocean Reef without an agenda. We just wanted to get away for a while. Whatever happened, happened. I found this beautiful orange spaghetti-strapped backless dress and decided to wear that. Though no one was going to see me other than Law Nim, I still wanted to look good for my man. Make his mind wonder why we were at dinner so that he can blow my back out once we made it to the room. I was dick-deprived and I needed some now, but I wasn't going to be selfish and hold up our night. Just the thought about having dinner on the top of a yacht seemed romantic as hell, and my man was far from that. If he had something like that planned, ain't no way I was about to miss it. By the time I was dressed, my makeup was on point and my hair flowed in effortless curls. Law was already dressed, sitting on the foot of the bed. From the scowl on his face, I could tell that whatever he was looking at on his phone wasn't pleasant. "You okay?" I asked him, since the phone seemed to have his full attention. He hadn't even noticed that I was ready. "Yeah," he quickly replied and slipped his phone into his pocket before rising to his feet. One thing about Law, if something was going on in his business affairs, he kept me out of them. Gripping me by the hand, he led me out of the room and up to the top deck. To say that it was decorated beautifully wouldn't do it justice. Him and Streets had gone all out. Red roses, lights, and ribbon lined the railing. Candles and rose petals made a trail toward two circular tables that sat at the end. Candles in the shape of a heart surrounded the tables. Turning to Law with a huge smile resting on my face, I said, "Let me find out that I be pulling out the softness out of you." Without uttering a single word, he led me over to the first table and pulled the chair out for me. Soon as my ass touched the seat, I saw Streets and Coco. She wore this white cocktail dress that blew every time the wind decided to hit us with a breeze. Her hair was pulled back in a bun at the nape of her neck with a diamond rose tucked beside it. "Y'all really outdid yourselves," she said as they approached the other table. "Only the best for y'all," Streets responded, and they sat down. Two women appeared out of nowhere carrying plates. They brought them over and set them down on the table in front of us. On mine, I had lobster tail, shrimp, and cheese grits with asparagus. It looked so delicious, I couldn't wait to dive into it. Law had to have requested this meal because he knew I was a seafood lover. It was the small things he did that made me love him even more every single day. I never knew it was possible to fall in love with a person all over again every day. Once dinner was over, Law and I found our way to the railing. Streets and Coco had retreated to their room. I took a swig of the champagne as I gazed out into pitch blackness. "I want you to be comfortable enough to be able to come to me about anything," Law calmly said as he pressed his frame against me from behind. Brushing all my hair to the left side, his lips caressed my neck and I moaned. "The next time you keep something from me, I'm going to punish you for it." You know I love when you punish me. His hands brushed my ribs and the hairs on the back of my neck stood up. I melted into him as his hands snaked over my hips. It didn't take a rocket scientist to know where they were going. He was searching for my pussy and I was here for it. His lips trailed up the side of my neck and found my earlobe. My pussy was drenching. I yearned to feel him fill me up so much that I wasn't even certain how much more I can take. Gripping my dress in his hands, he lifted it up over my hips. I sucked my lower lip into my mouth and bit down. Law's hand slipped in between my thighs, encountering my pussy. "Damn, you so fucking wet," he groaned in my ear. He gently massaged my clit through my soaking wet panties. "Only for you, I swear," escaped my lips. No other man walking this earth had ever turned me on the way Law had. It'll probably take God himself to pry me away from this man. I was never letting go of him, ever. "You want this dick?" he whispered, and my pussy throbbed. More than anything, his hand tucked underneath the band of my panties. One simple yank, and he ripped them off. I couldn't even tell how many panties he'd ruined in the past year. Law lifted my leg against the railing and his dick found my entrance. Palming his face, I turned mine and collided our lips to drown out the scream that threatened to seep from my lips when he entered me. His tongue soothingly stroked mine as he drilled me from behind. "Fuck," I moaned, nipping his lower lip. I tossed my pussy back on his dick to my best ability. Having sex on a balcony had always been one of my goals, but I think this took the cake. The massaging of my clit and the thrust of Law's dick brought me from my thoughts. That combo was undefeated. It came a close second to the one with the bullet. Fuck! I cried out, feeling my climax nearing. Come on, your dick, bae. He coached me, knowing damn well whenever he did that, I was never able to hold my orgasm. I released and could feel his seeds filling me up like a cream pie. Law slipped out of me, picked me up into his arms, and carried me to the bedroom. That night, that man made love to me all night long. And that's the end of that chapter. Okay, I'm still mad about the fact that he done knew all this time and she can't have no kiss. Like Tony Montana said. What'd he say? Her womb, it's got too much coke in it. I watch a Scarface tonight. Fuck out of here. Oh, good Lord. All right, y'all. This is it. We're going to stop right here. Because it's almost midnight. It's 15 minutes to midnight. So, yeah. Right, Demetia. She do need to tell him that. She needs to tell him. He needs to tell her now about Marsha's funky back ass. Because that rabbit ass fucking coyote. Damn, that bitch is a nasty back bitch. Okay, so wait. 1, 2, 3. So far it's only 3 more chapters that have this funky ass bitch in it. Good night, Jazzy. Yeah, it's only 3 more chapters that mention Marsha, but they spread far out. So I'm guessing. Good night, L Boogie. I'm guessing that, you know, it's not gonna be a lot, but we're gonna see. All right, y'all. So listen, I'm glad the internet held up. I'm excited. I guess that firmware update is really what it took, right? So that we don't have to worry about it cutting out on us tomorrow. And let me check and make sure Texas punk ass ain't expecting no rain tomorrow. Y'all just don't know. I'm sick of this raggedy bitch around here. Every time I turn around, I can't stand Texas, child. I don't even know what the fuck to say, but I can't take it. Oh my God, I'm so fucking, I hate it here. It's okay. It ain't gonna be long, baby. I promise you that. Oh God. All right, so I'm checking. I'm trying to see y'all to make sure that we ain't gonna be interrupted tomorrow. But I think we're okay. Don't seem like it's gonna be no fucking issues. I know some raggedy motherfucker down here in Texas ordered this fucking piggyback bullshit. I can't stand that shit. Y'all just don't know. They be wishing for the wrong shit and fucking up the church's money, you heard me? But anyway, all right, y'all. Like I said, this was fun. I appreciate you guys listening to me read out loud, and I hope I left y'all feeling better than you were when you got here, all right? Love Jones didn't get the chance to make it over here, child, and I don't know what to tell y'all about that, but maybe tomorrow she'll show up. I know she did have errands running, so. All right, y'all. Y'all have a great rest of your Saturday night, and I guess we're heading into Sunday morning now, but anyway. If you do nothing else, you guys, please salute your spirit and protect your peace. Until next time, and thank y'all for coming back, right? Even after the fuck up today. That shit was really on my nerves, y'all. So until next time, bye, y'all. I forgot to tell y'all I love y'all, but y'all know that already. But I love y'all. Bye. What y'all still doing here? The music is over. Get on away from around here. Bye, y'all.